Dr. Dharmasri likes to identify himself as one of the who has transcended from being an electrical engineer to the engineer of hearts and minds. Or rather, let me correct it properly, engineer of electrical to an engineer of hearts and minds. Why I say that is that it's his background from where he came from. But today, he is the acting director and the chairman of the board of Postgraduate Institute of Management, Sri Javadanapura, Sri Lanka. And also he is an adjacent professor of the Prince College of Business, University of Oklahoma in USA. He has about 2 decades of working experience. He doesn't come to the academia just like that. He has been working for over 20 years in government and the public and the private sector, and organizations like Unilever's and Nestle's. And he brings with that wealth of experiences. And also, today he's a working practitioner. He's an independent director for a development bank. And he does business consultancy for over 15 countries, which is Africa, in Africa, Asia, and Middle East. So he's truly a practicing professional or a practicing scholar, I would say. When he said that he transcends from electrical engineer to the transcending minds of people or coming into the business management, he doesn't hail or he didn't come from a business management background. In fact, he came from an electrical engineering background. His BSc was from the University of Morocco on BSc in electrical engineering. And he's a chartered electrical engineer after that. And he did his MBA and the PhD from Postgraduate Institute of Management, Sri Javadanapura. You could see the product of PIM where it can reach. As a student, today, he's at the pinnacle, the helm of that same institute, directing and guiding that institute towards its natural success. As a professional member, he's a member of the Chartered Institute of Management UK. He's a doctoral fellow of Commonwealth AMDISA, a Fulbright postdoctoral fellow. He has won many, many awards, accolades, including Gold Medal for Best Papers in 2 international management conferences. He is widely published internationally and locally, local academic journals, and written 2 books as well. In 2010, a Platinum Award was given by the alumni of Postgraduate Institute of Management alumni, Kalam. He recently won the most prestigious award from the IPM, Institute of Personal Management, a Lifetime Gold Award from 2014, the highest honor an HR professional in Sri Lanka could get. We are delighted to have such a personality today to talk to us. From an electrical engineering perspective, from the HR background, and the business, that crossbreed of his expertise, experience, and his scholarly knowledge is going to speak for itself today. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to Dr. Ajantha Dharmasri.
Thank you very much for the description, larger than life, I would say. And I'm indeed honored to be here. And the challenge is to live up to that. So how I typically start a program is by greeting you all. So let me do that now. Good evening.
Good evening.
For that particular good evening response that you all gave me, if you have to evaluate by giving marks out of 10, how much of marks you'll give? I greeted you and you gave me the return greeting. I'm looking at the return greeting. How much marks you'll give?
5
out of 10, right? How much marks you'll give, sir? Out of 10.
How much?
6 out of 10, all right. How much, ma'am? 5 out of 10. 5 plus 5, 10. 10 plus 6, 16. 16 divided by 3 is 5.33. So what does that mean? There's still 40% opportunity for improvement. I think the walls are fairly stable. Ceiling, there's no threat of collapsing on us. So we're absolutely secure here. So then shall we put our energies together in giving the best good evening that we have ever given to anyone? Just to show that we are enthusiastic. Just to show that we are energetic. Are we ready? So what is the target this time? Can it be 5 out of 10? No way. 7 out of 10? No way. It has to be nothing less than 10 out of 10. Alright? Good evening.
Good evening.
Wonderful. Give a big round of applause, please, and everyone here. Thank you. It keeps me going. So today, the topic I have lined for you is talent challenges for modern managers. Talent challenges for modern managers. Sorry for it. Just take the sharpness. So technical friend here. Suddenly went dark. One side there. All right. Okay. Right. So this has been my second home for the past 10 years, and this is my summer home where I go every summer to teach international human resource management. And it started with my Fulbright fellowship, and when they assigned me the task of teaching international HR. The Price College Dean told me a very interesting story. He said we had a very veteran teacher who was teaching international HRM, and the students received him very well, but we had a fundamental issue with him. He had never traveled outside Oklahoma State, but teaching international HRM. So that was a fundamental issue, but I resolved that issue and I'm continuing to be with them in teaching international HRM. So, talking about talent challenges, let me share with you my experience in dealing with talent. And these are some of my social interactions. I had been in many a public forum in sharing talent-related issues. And I write a weekly column to a daily Financial Times. It appears every Monday, ft.lk. And some of the things are which I did in electronic media, in Sri Lankan TV channels, and those are there in my website. And these are some of the glimpses of my training in more than 15 countries. And I was in the Philippines last year this time, just after the hurricane hit Philippines. And recently concluded a workshop for SAARC region, where all the public service commission officials of SAARC region came to Colombo. And South Africa, Bangladesh, and so many countries are here. So this is my summer teaching in US. The technology is absolutely fantastic. You have a touchpad. When you touch the pad, even the window flaps would move. Everything is well wired, well connected. And even more than that, coming from a rural area in Sri Lanka, in going to US and teaching them in their own language gave me additional satisfaction. And I start being very formal, and at the peak of summer, I might even do this. So this is the flexibility that we have in the US. Okay, so without further ado, let me straight away get on with the topic. So the central focus for the day is about talent. Talent-related challenges for all of you all, including me. And we consider ourselves as managers in the modern era. So therefore the term modern manager. So how would talent be critical to us? What can we do about it? So let me talk about the road ahead. I'm going to raise three fundamental questions and attempt to answer them within the next 1 hour or so. Three questions and try to answer together. And I must make a confession before anything else. Even though this device is here, I hate this device. Because this is not going to be a lecture. And even though I'm a senior lecturer before taking over the PIM, I was telling the same. Because my definition of a lecture is one person speaks and the rest all sleep. I hope that tragedy would not occur on this sunny Sunday evening. Instead, I would encourage an interactive discussion. Feel free to stop me, interrupt me, ask questions and clarify things and share your expertise. Then at least you will prove the point that you are still biologically awake and alert. All right? Okay, so with that understanding, let's move ahead. So, three questions to answer. Question number one. What are the key talent challenges facing the UAE and the Middle East and the globe in general? What are the key talent challenges we are going to identify? And what? The second question is, why are they important to organizations? Why do we worry about talent? Why should we worry about talent? And the third question I would argue is the most critical one. what should modern managers do about it? Is rather than knowing, we need to do something about it. What should we do? So at the end of the session, you need to have some idea, this is what I'm going to do about talent challenges. Some takeaway, I hope, would be. Is that a good way to spend next 1 hour?
Yes.
Can't hear. Is that a good way?
Yes.
Thank you. So let's move ahead. The fundamental question that might be in your mind is, what is this? Seems like the talent shortage really hit home this year. Funny animals. Here is Deloitte Consulting. So talent, talent, talent. Whole world has a talent thirst, talent drought. There was a book titled Winning the War for Talent. Talent magneting, talent attraction, talent retention, talent acquisition. Talent has become a buzzword in the business circles around the globe. So fundamental question, what is talent? What is talent? Any thoughts, any ideas? What is talent? So what are the thoughts that come to your mind when you hear the term talent? Ideas, talent?
To implement appropriate measures in a certain situation.
I mean the capability to implement appropriate measures in a certain situation.
Yes.
Very good, very good. Any other thoughts about from this side? Talent means what? Any thoughts? Yes?
Innovative.
I mean being innovative is being talented, right? Interesting. Anything from the
get the talent by the skill.
Skill is
repetitive.
Part of talent.
Yeah, skill is a repetitive.
Skill is a repetitive.
Repetitive skill gives us a talent.
Oh, right. Repetitive skill give you the talent. Right? Interesting. Anything from this side?
So specialized talent.
A specialized talent. And if being specialized in a particular area. All right? Interesting. So the word talent goes back to the biblical times in the Middle East. It comes from a commodity which was exchangeable. You exchanged talent to get something. So still that original value remains same. You have high value in talent. So among many definitions, I prefer this one, who is my friend, Professor David Ulrich from University of Michigan. Ulrich says talent equals a connection of three C's. So what are the three C's? C number one, competence, capability, the skill that you have, and commitment, the drive that you put into work. And contribution, the passion you bring into the scene. So three C's, talent equals competence multiplied by commitment, multiplied by contribution. All three are integrated, interconnected, intermingled. So that's what talent is. Interestingly, when you reflect upon this, you realize competence is something to do with your head. That's where your knowledge comes in. Know how and know what comes into the scene. It's the knowledge part. Commitment is the hands part. First the head, then the hands. In fact, what you do, your hands-on experience. And then contribution is where your heart comes into the scene. So in simple terms, I would call it 3H approach. Head, hands, and the heart. Unfortunately, in some of the countries that I have visited and done consultancies, they have hands, obviously. Head, they assume that they have. But the problem is with the heart. When the heart is missing, you are not fully there. In some countries I have seen, people come to work, they laugh, they smile, they crack a joke, and they park their car, and they put their heart also into the car park. And they come to work as if their heart did. So then you don't get the full contribution. And you don't get the required talent. So this is where the real challenge is. And again, there's a myth in the world, talent equals skills. No, it goes beyond the typical skills. So it has competence, commitment, and contribution. Three C's together would comprise talent. Are we in agreement? Is that clear enough? Because I believe in simple things. Because for me, simplicity is a hallmark of greatness. If you can simplify, you can simply fly. That's what I believe. Okay? Right. So, just gaze at this picture. What do you see here? Any thoughts? Seemingly like an? Supposed to be an orchestra. Who is in front? Conductor. Anything? Do you have some? And so, but are they in good shape or in bad shape? Looks like they're in good shape, but there's a problem. What is the problem? They don't have play. So can the music be performed? No way. You might have the best conductor in the world here. You might have the world-class equipment here, but still, without players, you can't conduct the orchestra. You can't have the music. So what is the simple point here? If you draw a parallel from this to a typical organization, what do you see? Who is this one? Some of you all might be occupying that position. The CEO or the manager in charge. And what are these?
Empty seats.
Resources, the R word, the magical R word. We have land, building, equipment, computers, and we bundle them together and we call it physical resources. And in order to get physical resources, we need money, financial resources. And we have a wide array of rules, regulations, procedures, processes, and we bundle them together and we use the word information resources. So you have physical resources, financial resources, information. I would argue all those three resources are useless, meaningless, if you don't have the most precious resource in any organization. What is that? All of you all, each and everyone, human resource, the only alive and vibrant resource in any organization, without which nothing can be possible. That's why I simplify saying people drive business. It's not your technology, it's not your products, it's not your service, it's people that drive. So some, when I say they disagree with me, saying, no, it's not HR, you need marketing, you need finance. So my simple argument, people doesn't mean HR, people means everyone in the organization, including the CEO. People management primarily is a key function of the leader, CEO. So it's not to do with HR. Everyone has to be a people manager. Everyone has to be a people developer. Everyone has to be a people engager. That's what I believe in, and that's what I always strongly advocate. Questions, clarifications, issues? So far, so good? Are you sufficiently confused or terribly confused? Not yet, so far? So far, so good? Right, let's move on. Talent drought across the globe. There's a problem of not having enough talent. This has been tested and proven by many surveys done around the world. So let me share with you three revealing statistics done by three leading global consultancy firms. First revelation from KPMG 2012. I know you can't read it, and that's not intended to be read. Which of these activities has your company's HR function focused on most in the past 3 years, and which will be focused most of the coming 3 years? Top one is retaining crucial talent. Retaining talent has been consistently the biggest challenge faced by global organizations. Past 3 years, future 3 years. Even future 3 years, it has been rated as more critical. So retaining talent is a huge issue across the globe. And that is first one. And interestingly, from Deloitte, second one, this is higher in Asia-Pacific region, much higher. I hope the Middle Eastern region also having talent issues, but significantly higher in Asia-Pacific. And the third one, let me elaborate further, PricewaterhouseCoopers, that is the most recent one. They say CEOs are increasingly worried about finding talent with the right skills. 63% of the CEOs are concerned about availability of key skills. It's a point of concern. It's a matter of concern for many CEOs. They are worried because they cannot get the desired results. They cannot get the expected results without having the required talent. And interestingly, 93% say they recognize the need to change their strategies for talent. However, only 65% haven't yet taken the first step. So it's very reactionary than proactionary. They are very reactive. That's another point of concern. And only 34% of the CEOs feel that their HR is well prepared for the challenges ahead. I take this as a pointer to highlight the challenging role for HR professionals. And again, let me clarify this point. Some people have this confusion. Every manager is a people manager, but HR professional is a specialized person who can advise the other people manager. So there's no role ambiguity. HR professional brings the wealth of expertise, but every manager makes the point that they manage people. Okay? So these statistics ring a bell, and it's an alarming thing where talent is going to be the critical factor in future. Without talent, nothing meaningful would be possible. So that's the first point I need to drive. And if you zoom into the organizational scenario from global, regional, and then to the organization, this is what I have seen as a consultant in many organizations, Sri Lanka, India, and many other countries. We have required talent. There's a clear identification of we need these jobs to be filled, these jobs are vacant, these skills are lacking in our organization, and so on and so forth. But unfortunately, they have only raw talent. There are people, there are numbers, the headcount is there, but the problem is headcount does not match the required. So there's a gap exists. There's a gap. And so many CEOs have lamented with me saying, look here, we need the talent, but we don't have. And some people even go on headhunting on a global scale. Now in Sri Lanka, where I come from, there are so many Sri Lankan organizations now having CEOs who are coming from other countries, from other regional countries, or even from the Europe. So that's a trend where there's a gap, required talent versus raw talent. And I'm sure the Middle Eastern region is a fitting example where without Asians, without Europeans, I'm sure Middle Eastern region is not yet ready to function on their own. And in fact, I remember a few years ago, I attended a research conference in Dubai. They talk about emiratization of talent, emiratization, where there's a conscious plan to convert skills, convert knowledge, where more and more people from the land would take over higher positions. But it might be a long journey where still there will be people coming from other regions of the world. That's the reality. Okay. So this is the gap that we need to fill. Now the question, how to fill this gap? And what can we do as managers? I believe managers are not damages, and managers are not messengers. They need to think and act. So what can they do about it? That's where I'm going to spend the bulk of my time. So let's start with Henry Mintzberg, a veteran management thinker. I thoroughly enjoy reading his books. His latest book, Strategy Safari, is a very interesting scenario about what strategy is. So this is what Henry Mintzberg says. Management is above all a practice where art, science, and craft meet. Very interesting three concepts. Art, science, and craft. It's so simple and so profound, so deep. So let's try to reflect on us. I'm sure all of us are managers. So are we having those triple dimensions in our managerial role? Those triple dimensions. So my suggestion is we need soul searching. As a modern manager, you need to be an artist, a scientist, and a craftsman in order to tackle talent challenges. So let me emphasize why. Why to be an artist? So, what is the primary role of an artist? Primary thing that an artist would do? Create something. Something of fresh, something novel, out of the box. Isn't that a role for a manager? Isn't that a role? Absolutely. You need to think afresh. You need to think out of the box. Of course, in order to think out of the box, what is the fundamental requirement? You need to know what the box is. In order to think out of the box, you need to know, press the box, then think out of the box, then challenge the box. So first, get to know the box properly. So that's artist. And scientist, what is the speciality of a scientist? Invention, experimentation, and I would say following a particular methodology, following a particular consistent process. All the process orientation comes with being scientific. If you do a research in Asia, if you replicate the similar research in USA, the same process is adapted, consistency is maintained. So that's scientific. And craftsman, this is where your hands-on experience matters. How you take the decision on the spot. The gut feel comes into the same craftsman. So I would say artist is more to do with your interpersonal skills, your relationship building. You have the rhythm, you innovate, you create. So, and scientist means you excel in your processes. Your, what is the word, your conceptual part comes into the scene. And craftsman is your hands-on technical experience. So you need to excel in all three fronts. So tonight when you go back, when you drive back, ask the question, of course, while driving with focus. Am I an artist? I'm not saying you to immediately go tomorrow to Lulu to buy a paintbrush and some paints, no. Artist in your approach. Am I a scientist in my approach? Am I a craftsman in my approach? Unless you have all three together, you are not a modern manager. You might have the title of a manager, but you might not be living up to the expectation. Agree? Disagree? You can disagree with me, no issue. Thoughts? Ideas? So does it make sense?
Yes.
Is it relevant to us? Is it relevant to UAE? Is it relevant what we do? Good, good. Let's move on. And this is my contribution. Challenges as 7 G's. This is my HR framework. I'm writing a textbook about this framework these days. So I would call it, it's a matter of 7 G's. So what are the 7 G's that we need to be thorough with? Every modern manager needs to be equipped with the tools and the techniques to tackle each G out of the 7 G's. So are you interested in knowing what those G's are?
Yes.
Are you interested?
Yes.
Thank you. First one is goal. The starting point, begin with the end in mind. That's what Stephen Covey advocates. Begin with the end in mind, goal. You need to have your vision and aligning with that mission. So that's a starting point. And then you need to get the right talent, you need to give them the right remuneration, grow them, glue them, and allow them to glow. And finally, guard them. So this is my simple framework. So shall we go through the details a little bit more about each G and see whether how they are relevant to us? Okay, let's start with the center G, which is the goal. I would see 3 things: alignment, integration, and execution. There is this interesting phenomena around the world. I'll show you a brief video clipping. Great grand strategies are confined to multicolored, spiral-bound volumes and volumes of documents. They are not converted into actions because there's an execution gap. Plans are being made, but they are not executed. But even before that, there's the issue of alignment and integration. If you don't know where we are heading, you would end up nowhere. I'm sure you would have heard the story of Alice in Wonderland. And Alice was a beautiful girl, and then when she saw the wild dream, Cheshire Cat comes to Alice and asks, Alice, where do you want to go? Alice says, I don't know. And then the cat says, go in any road will lead you to the point called, I don't know. Isn't this happening in our lives? In Sri Lanka, we have a nice cliche. We say, Danagana Giyot, Kataragama, Nodana Giyot, Ataramaga. Kataragama is a town, Ataramaga is nowhere. So that's why we use it. And in fact, when I said this to a Sri Lankan community, they say, oh, that's an old one, there's a new one. Danagana Giyot, Vattala, Nodana Giyot, Vattala. There are two new topics coming into the scene. Sorry, I mean, the context is that Vattala is a new airport, which is underutilized. They call it a white elephant. Okay, so the background for the others. So we need to have alignment, we need to have integration, we need to have execution. So starting point is having a vision. I like when Walt Disney says, if you can dream it, you can deliver it. So vision for me is the dream for the future. Every modern manager should be a dreamer. I like when I hear the song. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. John Lennon, my favorite song. You may say I'm a dreamer, I'm not the only one. Dream for the future. And I believe in daring to dream, daring to act, daring to fail, and finally dare to succeed. So dreaming is the starting point of a goal. every product, every service in the world was someone's dream, as I shared with the PIMA community day before yesterday. So the point is, you need to have a vision. In the holy text, it says, if you don't have a vision, you have division. Either you have a vision or you have division. And I remember once I went to a leading organization, and I asked from the CEO, what is your vision? The CEO was scratching his head, and he called the secretary, Sandra, come here. And she opened a locker and took out a frame picture full of dust and cobweb and told me, this is how. Vision is not there just to frame and hang. Vision is there to live. Vision has to be shared and supported. So the best example I can give you is from Disney World. In the Disney World, even the person who is sweeping the floor, who is collecting the dust, know why they are there for. And in fact, I read this in the book In Search of Excellence, and I wanted to test this. And I went to Disneyland and Disney World both when I was in US, and I asked this same question, and they gave me the wonderful, same, consistent answer. We are here to make people happy. This is the happiest place on earth. That's their vision, to make people happy. So simple. Vision is simple, but people live it in their hearts. Another example, when President John F. Kennedy, at the peak of Cold War, when there was a race to send the first man to moon between USSR and USA, it became a political battle as well. So when President Kennedy walked into the NASA laboratory as a typical politician to have a pat on the back and to encourage, he saw a lady sweeping the floor. And he greeted the lady and asked on the lady, lady, what are you doing? She said something very profound. She didn't say, I'm sweeping the floor. She said, I'm helping them to send a man to moon. I'm helping them to send a man to moon. So the connection, alignment, integration, all are there. So ask the fundamental question. First, am I aware of the vision of my organization? Second, am I connected to the vision of my organization? Psychologists say the real career success happens when your personal vision is aligned to the organizational vision. If they are at a cross, then you are just having a transient time, just a brief stay. So alignment is very important. So let me share with you a brief video based on a research done in US about the reality of knowing the goals and prioritizing them in daily life. It might look funny, and it might take you back to your childhood where you played. I'm sure you would have played soccer as kids. So this is about playing soccer. Sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Okay, so here's what we're going to do, right? Annie, I want you out on the wing. Trent, I want you to pick the pass to Annie. push the ball up the field and then pass the ball to your forwards, who are Sophie and Chris. Sophie, I want you to hold the ball and draw the defense out to you, all right? Then I want you to float a long pass all the way over the defense. Chris, you take it in for the score, just like we did in practice. Everybody got it? Let's go get them!
Do you see any similarities between Saturday morning soccer and Monday morning at the office? I mean, think about it. Too often, teams and organizations are unclear about the goals their top priorities really are. Coaches and players are simply not on the same page. What you get is everyone just kind of running around in all directions instead of working together toward the same goal. The inability to take high-level goals and strategies of an organization and then to translate those into action is a major problem with most organizations. It's one thing to come up with great strategies and goals, but it's quite another to actually get them done. This is what we can call the execution gap. In a landmark study done by the Harris Polling Group, we discovered some revealing statistics as to why execution breaks down and why goals aren't translated into action on the front line. First finding, only 15% of those surveyed can actually identify their organization's most important goals or top priorities. Either there are too many goals, or they change too often, or they simply don't have any. And in most cases, they are vastly undercommunicated. Just because the leaders are clear on what they want to achieve, it doesn't necessarily mean that the front line where the action really happens knows what the goals are. After all, in a very real sense, the front line produces the bottom line. Second, people may know what the goals are, but too often they haven't bought into them. Only 19% surveyed say that they feel passionate about the top goals of their organizations. That's only 1 in 5. There are a number of reasons for this, but the primary one is that they feel no ownership. They don't feel that they have input into what it's going to take to achieve the goal. They simply aren't emotionally connected to the goal. No involvement, no commitment. Third, those surveyed reported that they spend only 49% of their available work hours on their most important goals. The rest of the time is spent on urgent, but far less important activities. They get so distracted by urgent things that they neglect the most important things. Finally, people might know what the goals and top priorities are. They might even buy into them, but they don't know what they are supposed to do about them. In fact, 51% state that they personally do not understand what they are supposed to do to help the organization achieve its goals. Goals will not be executed until everyone clearly understands what the goal is and what they themselves specifically need to do to meet that goal. Once people are clear on what the goal is, then and only then are they free to try new and better ways to reach that goal. So the point is, to achieve goals you've never achieved before, you simply need to start doing things you've never done before. You might ask, is it possible to dramatically and measurably improve your team's ability to reach its goals? Can it really happen? My answer is absolutely. Just imagine the impact when everyone on the team is crystal clear about what the goals are. Imagine the energy and creativity that would be unleashed when everyone in the organization is committed and involved in achieving the goals. Consider the economic impact when everyone on the team is spending the majority of their time on top priorities. Just think what can be accomplished when every player on the team knows exactly what to do. The possibilities, my friends, are limitless.
Okay, just have a quick chat with your neighbor and share one Share one key takeaway from the brief video. That's a quick chat with your neighbor. They say, love thy neighbor, so this is the opportunity to demonstrate that. That's a quick chat. One takeaway from that brief video. What did you learn from the video? Anything? Okay, thoughts, ideas. So what did you see? First of all, did you enjoy the video?
Yes.
So the kids playing soccer with the coach can be compared to what? Typical organization, CEO and the team, the leader and the team. And were they engaged? Were they involved? One girl was chasing a dog and one was having a chat with someone. And the third one was the fun. One who scored the reverse goal to the same side. And the funniest one was the game boy. He was sleeping all the time. Then Stephen Covey comes to the scene. Sorry, before that, the leader found enough is enough. And he calls a high-powered meeting. And everyone is summoned. And how did he explain? Simple way or complex way? Very complex way. He took diagrams, vectors, arrows, codes, and everything. And finally, what happened? They were further confused. And they went and got into further mess. And Stephen Covey, one of the veteran management thinkers, I like him, he's my favorite author, he comes to the scene and says, the similarity between Saturday morning soccer and Monday morning and? So what is the similarity? He passed the ball all the time, isn't it? But apart from that, yeah? Not clear. So the revealing statistics, four revealing statistics, can you remember? Among those who surveyed in the US job market. First one, who can remember? Only 15% of the people knew what their priorities were. And the second one, more shocking, only 19% were passionate, that one out of five. So that means four people out of five have a heart issue. Their heart is elsewhere, probably with someone else. And then the third one, about what? Time utilization. They spend half of their time doing other things. Firefighting, professional firefighters. The moment they go to work, they do firefighting. And the fourth one, for me, is the fundamental paradox, fundamental question. What is the fourth one? 50% of the people did not know what they were supposed to do in order to achieve organizational top goals and priorities. So clarity factor is absolutely necessary. Clarity factor. In Buddhism, where I'm coming from, they say samma ditti, right seeing, should lead to samma vayam, right action. Right seeing should lead to right action. That's what is needed. Clarity factors. Alignment. I'm sure Christianity, Islam, all great religions talk about having a clear set of goals, isn't it? That's the fundamental. So are we clear? So take something out of it and reflect on it as we move along. And second G, let me move on, is getting the right talent. And I have a simple model for this. As an academic, I can't help presenting models, but I'll make it as practical as much as possible. I would call it triple fix. In fact, I wrote this in the PIMA-UAE journal. If you want further details, the article that I wrote talks about this triple fit model. I would say hiring someone, getting someone to an organization is a case of fulfilling triple fits. What is fit number one? Task, talent, fit. You have a task of a driver and you want to hire a driver. How would you do that? You ask the driver to make a PowerPoint presentation, 7 habits of highly effective drivers. Is that what you do?
No.
No way. You give the key and ask the fellow to drive. So task, talent, fit. Task, talent. If the person doesn't, if the talent is not there for the task, forget it. Forget it. That's it. Second one, person, position, fit. person position. You might have a very serious laboratory job where a committed scientist have to work in isolation for a longer period of time, and you get a salesperson who is very talkative, who is very outspoken, who wants to go and talk to people. Do you think there will be person position match? No way. You need to have right person to match the right position. And the third one is the subtlest one, individual institution fit. Sometimes I have seen people come from private sector, they don't fit into the public sector jobs. People come from multinationals, they don't fit into the sometimes the family-oriented business. In Sri Lanka, we have this funny scenario where family companies are run by sometimes husband and wife. So the decisions taken at the boardroom are changed in the bedroom. Those are some of the complexities. So you have individual institution fit. So again, going deeper, I would say hiring success depends on, this is technical. You have to check the technical fit when hiring someone. That's the talent acquisition. And you have to check the psychological fit. Here we have set up assessment. Here we do psychometric testing and few technical tools are available. But this is for me the most difficult one, socio-cultural fit. Recently, the leading insurance company in Sri Lanka, I know their CEO very well, and I knew their head of HR, who happened to be one of my students. And they had a small issue, and the head of HR left the leading insurance company in Sri Lanka. So I met the CEO at a dinner, and I casually asked, how is your HR doing? And he said, you know, we had a small issue. I mean, there was this fellow, and his chemistry doesn't fit well. His chemistry was not okay. I'm sure he was not referring to organic chemistry or analytical chemistry or other type of chemistry. He was talking about this. Socio-cultural. It's difficult to measure, but it matters. Sometimes you have the instinct, this person is not fitting to the remaining team members. This person is more a virus than a value-adding person. So you have to make that decision. So these are the triple fits. Technical fit, absolutely must. That's the starting point. But my point is that people stop here without doing the other two. Don't stop here, then do the other two. Psychological fit, which you need some expertise, either from a consultant or some outside. Where this one, where your experience, your maturity matters. So technical fit, psychological fit, and socio-cultural fit. Those fits would ensure you get the right talent, hiring success. Without hiring success, you can't have talent in your work. Agree? Sounds good? Now think about it. Where do we lack? Are we lacking here? Are we lacking here? Or are we lacking here? In fact, what are the, I would say, recommendations that you can make to your organization in order to strengthen technical aspect, psychological aspect, and socio-cultural aspect? Any questions on this model? I'm trying my best to simplify models, but models are important. Questions, clarifications, issues, bouquets, brickbats? Well, okay. So far with me?
Dr. Weil, yes. Believing technical and socio-cultural can be judged, but then yes. I think psychological thing is something which is complicated, right?
Yeah, but there are advanced techniques, like you give a questionnaire, and the way they answer the question, you can profile their personality. So like MBTI, or even Big Five, even they call DISC method. There are a variety of tools available. Some might be expensive, some might be not so expensive. So here you need expert support. But the other two, I'm sure you can manage. And even here, socio-cultural, you might have some behavioral scenarios where they say, think about the past situation. And sometimes the point is, with my experience, people come to interviews and they are the superhero in the whole universe with the nice CV. And when you look at the CV, they are like the superhero in the whole universe. But when you start interviewing, the image gets shattered and shattered and shattered. You need to see through. You need to ask critical questions. Again, we have this issue in Asia where we think we are good in interviewing. And no one wants to get trained on interviewing. But I would say interviewing is a skilled activity where anyone is not a natural interviewer. You need to train yourself. But some of the CEOs, they think, what did they have to learn in interviewing? I'll ask you questions and I'll select the fellow. That's bad. That's unprofessional. Okay? Right.
Question.
Yes.
Question. If you are faced with the question as a manager that you have somebody really good, but he doesn't fit into that.
Yes.
I mean, what kind of priorities would you give if there is a, you say there's a shortage, and it is true, especially in this market.
Yes.
And when you are dealing with niche markets or something, you cannot find the right people all the time. Sure. And then if you go into these three aspects, it's even more harder.
Sure.
What would your recommendation be? What could you take as a priority?
Excellent question. Thank you. I would say you have to live with it. And given the scenario, if there are gaps here, I would say if there are gaps here, it's a fundamentally recruitment mistake. If there are technical gaps, say if you hire a quantity surveyor who cannot do quantity surveying, fundamental technical mistake. So I don't think that happens. I think more these two are the prevalent ones. So this one, I would say through coaching to some extent,
training.
You can train, say organizational values, organizational culture, what you expect from every employee in your organization. So this side need coaching, this side need training. But this one, I would bet if you get a misfit, better let them go. Because you can't tolerate underperformers who are lacking in technical skills. Technical skills are the primary requirement for you to give the job, isn't it? I mean, you can't take a risk of giving a vehicle to a driver who doesn't know how to drive. Simple as that. If you I know people from Emirates, if you ask a pilot to, if you ask a pilot to be a trainee and take the plane, they might take the plane to heaven, not to Havana or not to Hawaii, isn't it? Is the point? So you need to have that technical fit, primer. Agree? Any other questions?
Is that have the same equal weightage of these three factors?
That's a good question. Equal weightage. How do you proportion it? I would say, typically, in the past, we had been giving more weightage here. Typically. Some even give 100% there. But I would say, proportionately, my bet is that, let's say, 40, 30, 30. Still, this has a higher edge. That's why I put in on top. But other two are complementing, more complementing. This is more necessary. These two are more complementing. But essentially, you need all of them. Okay? Shall I move on? Yes, please.
Another thing is my personal experience in the test. I had two tests and about 1.5 hours sometime. So many questions and difficult to concentrate throughout the 1.5 hours.
So that's too long.
Most of the people, they are just clicking the answer.
That's another important aspect. I don't want to go into details due to that. Time constraints where I would not advocate just a test. I would propose a system where we do successfully in several countries called assessment center. An assessment center is a battery of several assessments bundled together. Say a brief IQ test, a brief presentation, brief case study, brief role play, brief team game, where you give different activities and you assess them in those scenarios and you compile and you get a comprehensive view of the person rather than just giving a web-based IQ test. They might excel in the IQ test, but emotionally they might not be ready. So there are fundamental issues with just having one solo test. I prefer an assortment of tests rather than one test. But the downside is that it needs more time, more resources and more money, just financial commitment. So that's a challenge. But if you invest that, you get the better talent. Clear? Good. So let us, yes, please.
So there's psychological expertise concern.
Yes.
Now, some managers are intuitive, and some managers are sincere. So intuitive managers are the managers who can see the big picture and goal setting. That part. And the intuitive, the sensing managers can see detail oriented.
Yeah, you're dependent on MBTI.
Yeah. So how you advise this model to be applied for the sensing managers?
Interesting question. Again, the big five, I don't want to go into detail. Sorry, the MBTI. The point is that it depends on the job. Say, if you want to take a creative copywriter, if you want to take an advertising expert, you take more intuitive. So your personality should match the position. But if you want to take someone who is a tea taster, who is a laboratory analyst, who has to use more sensors, then you have to check that in the personality profile. So personality profiling is a very detailed topic. where you have categorization, different personality types, and different techniques are there. Where my simple point is, first you need to identify what position requires what personality. That understanding has to be there. I mean, the simple thing, if you want to sell like hell, you don't get a person who is very shy and soft-spoken and a deep thinker, isn't it? So that personality does not match the selling requirement. You have to go and talk to people, impress people, make a first impression. Simple like that. So person, position, match is where. Clear? It needs detailed technical analysis. All right? Okay, so let's move on.
One more question.
Yes.
If I had to do this, how would I edit the experience? But you have not done, what is the reason?
This covers experience. Socio-cultural fit. Because for that person, working in different environments would be more adaptable to your environment based on the experience. Rather than someone working in one organization for 25 years doing the same thing over and over again, I would prefer someone having cross-industry, cross-organizational experience. So that experience helps you to get more adaptable. Okay? Any other questions?
Right. I also so, feel not the technical goes, the experience goes, the technical, right?
Technical is more the knowledge that you bring. There's a little bit of experience here as well, I agree.
Well, yeah.
But majorly it's more the knowledge that you have as know-how. Know-how comes there. I mean, in order to tackle something and to handle your task. Right? So I'm so happy that there's a lot of interest on this model. Please read that article. It will elaborate further on this. Can I move on then? Okay. And interestingly, in line with getting David Ogilvy, one of the advertising tycoons in the world, Ogilvy, advertising, he says, if each of us hires people who are smaller than we are, we shall become a company of dogs. But if each of us hires people who are bigger than we are, we will become a company of giants. So it's your judgment call whether you need to be a company of dogs or company of giants. It's your call. Simple as that. Some people bring their egos into the scene and they are scared, they are little less confident, they are insecure when they are a smarter fellow reporting to you, which I would say is fundamentally wrong. If you get a smarter person reporting to you, you can together do smarter things. You can become a better leader by guiding the person, motivating the person, rather than considering that person as a threat to you, as a risk to you. No, it should not be the way. So this is what David Ogilvy advocates. And this is what I would strongly recommend for everyone. Not a company of dogs, but company of giants. And now let's move to the third G, grow. It's very straightforward. Training, development, and guidance. For me, training is an investment, not an expenditure. It's an investment for future. You got to train people to handle things. So training, development, and guidance go hand in hand. Training is to do something, development is to be someone. Guidance is in between, giving regular feedback. So this G is of utmost importance. I come from HRD mostly, human resource development, where developing people to handle higher things in time to come is of extreme importance. Any thoughts?
Reward.
That's coming. That's another G. So that this G is all about growing. The other G is about giving. So that's there. Any thoughts? So are you paying enough emphasis on training? Sometimes training becomes just a way of spending money. I once got a surprise call from a CEO. He happened to be a classmate of mine. He said, are you available on a particular Sunday? I said, yes. Now we are going to have an annual trip because we made some profit last year. So I want to utilize that profit, but I don't want these fellows to enjoy the whole day. So can you come and spend half a day in doing some training? I said, what is the topic? No, you select any topic. And I don't want them to spoil the whole day. Let them have some learning in the morning half and in the afternoon, let them enjoy. Is that a good approach to training?
Yeah, it's fantastic.
I don't think so. Spending half a day for learning just on ad hoc thing without even identifying proper needs?
No, because it all depends on the atmosphere or the the atmosphere. Okay?
Okay.
Like when you are in the office, the mindset is in the office.
Okay.
But then if you're, let's say, if you're on a holiday, okay, half day or a morning session,
yes,
if we utilize in a certain atmosphere,
okay,
where their minds can be, you know,
interesting point.
Yeah.
So any counterpoint?
It can, yes, be really effective.
It can be mixed up with team building kind of a thing.
Exactly. So you need to appropriate it in.
Exactly.
So without spoiling the enjoyment part,
yes,
the learning,
yes,
part should be coupled with enjoyment. So my point is that you need to plan it.
Plan,
you need
it
to,
yes,
identify the needs.
You
now the problem is a lot of people don't identify the needs.
But
they straight away go for training.
But that's why he called you as your friend. Trusting on you that you,
yes,
will get the right topic into the right place. That's why maybe he says that, okay, do whatever, because he knows that you will not do,
yes,
some unimportant things for the event.
But he did not assume that I had to do some homework, I had to go to the organization and do a detailed training need analysis to identify what they need, and he was not willing to pay for me. That's the
downside.
So my simple point is that it has to be a process rather than an ad hoc one event. It has to be a process. The whole process has to be there. Okay. See the point? And interestingly, next one, as Mr. Deepal very rightly said, is giving remuneration, reward, and recognition. If you give peanuts, you get monkeys. That's a peanut. And if you give less dollars, you get donkeys. And the payment is very important. And even if we revisit Maslow's need hierarchy, even though it has been thoroughly challenged, still there was a recent survey done in India among CEOs, and they still say the highest motivator is money. Biggest motivator is money. But the difference is, earlier they would have earned money for their own expenses. Now they are earning money for their loved ones, for their children's education. We had a professor who said every single cent he earned, he used to send to US for the education of their children. So your needs are different, but money matters. No one is doing work for charities, except for religious ones. So remuneration, I would say exceeding the market. I think in the Middle Eastern region, I don't think remuneration is a major issue. But the reward and recognition, it's not just the money, but how you recognize people giving pat on the back. So appropriate giving is very important in order to retain. So giving is a vital aspect. Are we clear? Next one is, for me, I would spend a little more time gluing. Glue means all about engaging employees. I attended several international HR conferences, including the most recent one in UK, where I came 3 days ago, where employee engagement was a central topic among the CEOs, among the leaders around the world. How do I engage my people better? How do I ensure that my people are engaged? Again, one such great giant, Sir Richard Branson. Of course, he's in a bad mood these days. His rocket got blasted, but I think he's still in high spirits. So this is what Richard Branson says. I like him because the BBC coined a new term to interpret him. The world's first astropreneur, who's an astropreneur, astronomer plus entrepreneur, astropreneur. His newest business is taking people to outer space. I hope he will do that properly. This is what he had to say. Just read out while the words are coming. So what is the typical marketing mantra? Customer first? Customer first? He said, no, staff first. Is this a contradiction or a confirmation? What do you think? How many of you all say it's a contradiction? How many of you all say it's a confirmation? Why?
It's a confirmation, yeah.
Why?
You can see the results.
Yeah, staff. If they are unhappy, if they are demotivated, if they are disgruntled, do you think they can go and satisfy the external customers? No way. So internal customers have to be properly looked after. That's a talent challenge. Something I really believe, he doesn't say I guess, I speculate, I assume. No, he says I, a deep internal conviction. And therefore, to create a friendly, supportive, non-hierarchical, family-like atmosphere. Family. I remember when I was at Unilever, my first job, we had a magazine called Leave a Family. Leave a Family. And when I joined Nestle, they had a newsletter called Nest. Because Nestle means a little nest with the mother bird and the two other birds. Nest, it's a family. In singular, we say cadell. So it's all about family-like atmosphere. In all my companies, an ambience in which people have fun and enjoy themselves. Fun is fundamental for success. Without fun, people don't have results. And in some Western companies, they have a new measure called laughs per hour. Laughs per hour. In the Middle Eastern region, it might be a little challenging at the given context, but laughs per hour. So I remember someone sharing this with me. He went to Vienna. And he was taken around a dairy factory. And it was pick and span, he was thoroughly impressed. And at the end of the factory visit, he asked the question, why do you call your products happy cow? And the answer was, our cows are happy. When the cows are happy, they give the highest quality milk. And we use that highest quality milk to make the highest quality dairy products. And he asked, how do you make the cows happy? And he was told that they give the best nutrition, they look after the cows well, and they even occasionally hug them. So my question is, if they can look after the cows that much well, how about human beings? We need to cater for human beings. We need to look after our people. Happiness factor is a fundamental requirement to be productive. Even the conference I attended in Manchester reconfirmed my conviction that happy people become far more productive. If you're not happy, it affects your productivity. So make people happy, have fun and enjoy themselves, that atmosphere, ambience. I had a challenge in Nestle when I was the head of HR in the technical division. I had two factories for me to look after the people. We had aging workforce, elderly people, and there were a lot of retirements. And every time when someone retires, we organize a small retiring function. And we invite the retiring person to say a few words. Every time I do that, the person comes and say, now that I am retired, I can do the things that I love to do. Think about this. Now that I am retired, I can do the things that I love to do. Do you see an issue here? So what is the issue? What about the things they do before the retirement? Things they have to do, things they are asked to do, things they are forced to do, not necessarily things they like. And I remember having a friend. When I was going to the canteen, I passed his cubicle. He had a whiteboard in his room. He has written a three-digit number, 300. The second day it was 299. The day after it was 298. I asked him, Maja, what is the number? He said, I have started a countdown to my retirement. I hope the situ is not so bad here. So the point is, you need to make people enjoy what they do. In fact, love the work you have to do. You might not have the opportunity to do the work you love to do all the time, but at least love the work you have to do. Simple as that. Enjoy. That's the starting point. Happiness factor. And if you have time to do a YouTube search, there's a beautiful clipping. I thought you would have seen this. It's a Sri Lankan security guard in Moni's Hotel, Beruvala. The happiest person on earth. Just do a Google search. His name is Karuna Pala or someone, and that video clipping, there's an English subtitles. It talks about how happy this person as a security guard. So it's how you make yourself happy. Right. So engagement for me is, this is from Gallup Consulting. They do engagement surveys around the world. By the way, how many of you all do engagement surveys? Annual engagement survey? So what is the company that you hire? Gallup. So Gallup is a leading consultancy firm. So they talk about three simple things. Say, stay, and strive. Say means what? Freedom of expression. Express yourself. Sometimes when the boss is saying something, you are burning inside to say no. But you say, yes, sir, three bags full. And the boss points to a palmyra tree and say, look at this coconut tree, man. And you say, yes, sir, there are some nut souls. Say. You are not saying what you mean, and you should have the freedom to say what you mean. And I am so happy to say PIM has gone through an era where I was extra careful in picking my words, in saying, because I was so concerned about what would be the reaction from my boss long time ago. But now the things have changed. My immediate boss, who is my mentor and teacher, was completely, I had much freedom to say. When you have freedom of expression, you tend to be more creative. You tend to come up with a lot of original ideas. You are not restrained or constrained, so diplomatic. There was this nice cartoon in a Sri Lankan newspaper, the cabinet meeting presided by the president. And the president says, I would like to propose, even without him completing the sentence, everyone says, I agree. Even without him completing that. So that's not, I'm not taking any sides here. The point is just a point of view. And staying engaged employees are having a long stay with the organization, partnering for progress and striving. No point just saying and staying without contributing to the best. They need to perform to the fullest. So say, stay, and strive. Three very important aspects. Just have a quick chat with your neighbor. Are these relevant to us? In your workplace, do you see people saying the right thing? Do you see people staying, at least till their contract is over? Or do you see people striving, giving their best to the organization? Have a quick chat. Cultural constraint, I know. In my experience, so saying might be the most difficult one. And the subtle one is driving. You have to contribute to your. Okay, let's move to the next one. For me, it's the most critical one, glowing, shining with your performance. It's all about managing performance. This has been a thorny issue around the world because performance management systems are more hated by people than loved by people. There's a lot of disagreement, there's a lot of disillusionment about this. So there are three things. Results, key performance indicators, you need to be very clear, carefully designed set of KPIs. How many people are having KPIs? Key performance indicators, that's very important. And then I would propose KBIs, key behavioral indicators. This is not very much seriously taken. Relationships, key behavioral indicators. I propose something like critical incidents, where if someone does something extremely well, being extremely supportive, you make a note. How they behave, if you're not achieving results either by hook or by crook. And reinforcement, gap filling. And you need to identify if they are falling short, you need to do some gap filling. Either training, coaching, or if everything fails, show the exit door. Because you are not running a charity organization. You're running a business organization which is profit oriented. But do it in an extreme gentle manner. At least show the exit door in the nice way. In US they call it, they issue a letter saying what performance related, they call it, there's a nice word. They don't even use the word you are fired. They say you are they camouflage with words. So the point is that you handle it in a decent manner. That because in Asia and the Middle Eastern region, I know some cases where losing a job is a major issue. It's a social calamity, it's a social factor, so you need to handle this very, very carefully. I would always propose from a humanitarian point of view, give them a second chance, but not a third chance. They had to take the second chance seriously, but not a third chance. Agree? Okay, let's move on. GUARD, final G. It's all about policy setting, employee discipline, and values in action. You got to have a clear set of policies in place where people know what the policy is. And employee discipline. Without discipline, nothing meaningful can be achieved. proper discipline has to be maintained and the value. I would strongly recommend, in my view, the best CCTV system in the world, close connected TV system, the closed circuit TV is your conscience. I had many opportunities. If you go to a supermarket, you can grab something, keep it in your pocket, and slowly walk away without paying. But what prevented me doing that is conscience. Your conscience has to be your powerful indicator. So you have value-based discipline. Your norms will make sure that you have proper behavior, values in action. So let me propose two V's. I'm sure there are financial people here. So what is that? At the end of the day, your organization success is judged by what? Your value. Value means what in financial terms? Your net worth? Value. But my argument is you can't have that value without values, plural. Values are where the human beings have to demonstrate values. So CORE, core values are very important. How many of you all have core values in your organization? Set of core values you all have? In Sri Lanka, this thing happened. I went to an organization and I asked from the CEO, tell me what are your core values? He looked around and asked others, core values? The word core in singular means where are the values? So instead of asking about CORE values, they were looking around, asking the question, where are our? So in that sense, this is very interesting. Warren Buffett, I think the richest person on earth, isn't it? Warren Buffett, this is what he had to say. I look for three things in hiring people. First is personal integrity, is a value. Value part comes here. Second is intelligence. Third is high energy level. But if you don't have the first one, the other two will kill you. Other two will kill you. So what is the point? If you take a talented person with wrong value system, you are introducing a virus to your organization, isn't it? That's very dangerous. Talented people with wrong values are far more dangerous than people with right values and less talent. See the point? Very, very important. So keep that strongly in your mind. And talking about values, value is not about what you give, but what others get. Just gaze at this picture. What do you get? What do you get? You just reflect. Value is not about what you give, but what others
get.
So what is the point? These lions in Africa, they get shelter. And when the pilot comes, I don't know their reaction. What others get. Okay. So the reality around us, let me go fast, is about change. To do all those things in handling talent, in managing talent, you've got to change. So the final little bit is about change. We have to change as modern managers, isn't it? Without change, nothing is possible. The only permanent thing in the whole world is change. And who is this one? There's the only person who likes change. All others hate change. A baby with a wet diaper. The only one who likes change. Everyone else hates change. Because change is uncomfortable. Change is making your life a little difficult. You have to change. Any guess what you see here? Something is being unloaded from Pan American Airline aircraft. What is being unloaded? Any guess? Long time ago.
Computer.
Any other guesses? What is being unloaded?
Engine.
Engine. Any other guesses? From that side? You are somewhere there, but not a computer, part of a computer. Hard disk. Hard disk in 1956, 5 MB storage. See the way the world has changed. Way the world has changed. In my pocket there's 64 GB. Very tiny. In fact, I got first one 16 GB. The second one even smaller, 64 GB. Four times higher capacity, smaller the size. Change through technology. We can't afford to miss out this change. Change through technology. Mr. Ajantha, can I take another 3 minutes to, interestingly, there's a very interesting video I got from YouTube. By the way, the earlier one about the soccer is also available in YouTube. And this is about how technology changes our lives. Okay. technology changes our life. What does it all mean? Okay. with all me. This is the point I want to stress at the end. What do you see here? The extinct in the wild, but some still exist in the corporate world. You can identify some of these. And if you happen to be one of them, I can assure you one thing, there's a place reserved for you in the Jurassic Park. So what is the simple point I'm making here? In order to handle talent challenges, let me reconnect. You got to, as a modern manager, you need to change. Change your ways of approaching and have a proper mindset. And I would suggest, instead of becoming dinosaurs, you got to become dolphins. If you want further details, I have written an article, Dinosaurs versus Dolphins. Dolphins thrive in turbulences. They don't struggle and die, they thrive. So we need to have the dolphin mindset instead of a dinosaur mindset. Simple point is, either you're distinct or you're extinct. Distinct as a dolphin or extinct as a dinosaur. It's a choice. Choice is yours. Simple act. Choice is yours. Again, so let me reiterate, talent is important, it's critical, and we need to search for talent, we need to manage talent. And you need, if you need more details, these are the books that I have written, and those will give more details. And my website also has some information. I hope this is the way or not the way. Sure? By the way, these are called incentives. I hope this does not represent anyone in the room, I presume. But instead, I would strongly recommend what this great man had to say, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. The difference between what we do and what we are capable of doing, there's a big gap. Would suffice to solve most of the world problems. What we are doing and what we are capable of doing, there's huge. So only way to reduce the gap is to unleash human potential. That's where in the PIM, we have got the new theme, Igniting Human Imagination. Unleash the potential for future. That's the future. That's the future. That's the central point. If you hire talent, this is where it will go. It will solve most of the world's problem. Agree? Make sense? Okay. Let me stop for a while. I hope this is not your mindset right now. If you have questions, clarification, anything that I was not clear enough, let's spend a little time. A beautiful book by Tom Peters called Brand You. You as a brand. For example, what's your full name, sir?
Sanat Karunagoda.
Sanat Karunagoda. There's only one Sanat Karunagoda in the whole universe, isn't it? Whole universe. There's only one Sanat Karunagoda. So that's a brand. So you have to showcase your brand. What is your uniqueness? Just do a Google search. There's a beautiful YouTube clipping, Strength Finder by Marcus Buckingham. Strength Finder. It talks about focus on your strength. Focus on your strength. I did that 10 years ago. I realized I'm more good at teaching than doing engineering. That is a self-reflection. So I took the transition. I'm more a trainer and a teacher than an engineer. I realized that. So find your strength and do something which matches your strength. Don't worry about your weaknesses. Focus on your strengths. Strength Finder. That's the latest research by Marcus Buckingham. He's from Gallup. He's from Gallup Consulting. Marcus Buckingham. Absolutely. Strength Finder. That's where the future is. So focus on your strength and showcase I am strong in this area. And then you glow. Others will spot and hire you, talent spotting you. Show that you are good. And the social media will be a very powerful tool. LinkedIn, Facebook, and other social media, Twitter. Show your talents. The social network has become very powerful. Have I answered sufficiently? Any other questions we can take? Mr. Ajantha, one more question?
Yes, sure.
Any other question? Yes?
Yeah. The triangle you showed, the module,
yes.
One aspect of the social aspect and the psychological aspect.
Social, cultural, psychological aspect. Yes.
Today I believe the social media plays a greater role because an interview of 15 minutes or half an hour, you probably will not be able to understand the social cultural background.
Sure.
But what you post in the social media recruiters look very strongly in that, identify who
your
you
attitudes.
Are,
your
attitudes, who you are. Is it relevant today?
Absolutely. In fact, I am doing a research these days. The social media related hiring. I'm doing it in the Sri Lankan IT sector with another student. The impact of social media on hiring. There were cases in UK where a person puts a posting where I got drunk and we had a nice party, and then the boss intercedes this, and then it had a negative consequence. And sometimes a person has put a posting criticizing the boss and it was shared by someone else. These things are there. But there's a terrible downside to some of these things. A pastor from Malaysia shared this with me. There was an 18-year youth in Kuala Lumpur logged into Facebook and put a posting, I'm going to commit suicide in 45 minutes. And he put the clock clicking. There were 30 people logged in and said, I liked it. This is the reality that we are living. Teenagers straight go to the room, open their computer, and they are showing their faces to everyone in the world except for their parents outside. Social issues. So I'm extra cautious in using social media, but I see more strengths than short term. That's the reality. Okay? All right. Well done is better than well. I can keep on talking and talking and talking, but what matters is not that, but what you do with that. That's what is important. So I thoroughly enjoyed being with you all. And there's an invitation from PIMA-UAE alumni. We would formally close the session. And if anyone is interested in PIMA-MBA, which will be offered in Dubai very soon, you can stay back. We'll have a very informal 10-minute discussion about PIMA-MBA being offered. I don't want to make it part of this one. We'll have a separate discussion. Those who are interested can stay back for 5 to 10 minutes informal. Right, so interestingly, this is not a closing but a beginning. A new way of looking at talent, a new way of approaching talent, a new way as a modern manager engaging in talent. So may the journey be a happy one, enjoyable one, and fruitful one. So the journey continues. So from the bottom of my heart, may I wish you good luck for voyage, all the very best. Visit my website for further details. And shall we put our hands together in a way? The city of Dubai has never heard before. A thundering round of applause to everyone. Everyone here. A big round of applause. Thank you. That's all the news I got for you tonight.
Thank you, Doctor.